I now have the pleasure to introduce Quentin Guignard from University of Paris, so Université de Paris. We'll talk about étale covers with bounded ramification.
Thank you for the introduction, for the invitation. So, yes, étale covers with bounded ramification. Without further ado, I will delve right in. My main inspiration is an old result of Pierre Deligne from the early 80s, which is as follows. If you take a local field, K, or more generally, a complete discretely valued field with perfect residual field, then if you fix some integer n, the category of finite separable extensions of K with ramification bounded by n can be recovered from this residue ring, OK mod maximal idle over n. Okay. So first, one should notice that we can have two different local fields that have the same residue ring for some n. It is even possible to have two such local fields with different characteristics, like zero and p. And this was the original motivation for Deligne. It was a way to formalize reasoning, which had been used many times before for translating results from a classic zero to classic p, or possibly conversely. Okay. More recently, 2013, Shin Hattori extended this result. So still for a complete discrete valued field, but this time with a possibly imperfect residue field. So this is much more complicated in spirit because the structure of extension is a lot more complicated. In the perfect residue field case, we have always a monogenic extension, and we can rely on the theory of a Newton polygon of a polynomial. It's fairly simple and elementary. In general, there is no certainty that the extension is monogenic, and the Newton polygon is not as effective to understand the ramification. So the original work by Deligne, ramification was understood using the Hilbert function. So it is a very classical definition. And for Shin Hattori, in his work, ramification is defined using the Abbe-Saito theory. So this is 20 years ago. So this result by Deligne is came later than the Fontaine-Wittenberger well-known theorem. So for those who don't know, the Fontaine-Wittenberger theorem is isomorphism of an absolute Galois group for some fields, one of which is classic zero and periodic, and the one is classic P. So in essence, it's the same spirit as what Deligne was doing. And actually, one can recover the Fontaine-Wittenberger equivalence from Deligne's results by going to the limit here. So this is one possible motivation, but in a way, it is finer than the Fontaine-Wittenberger equivalence because it is at the finite level without going to the tower. Limit over tower. For higher rank evaluations, we still have notions of ramification and ramification filtration. For complete intersection, it was studied and defined by Saito, still using the same theory as in Abbe-Saito, so either by evaluative space or by dilatation. And then, more recently, there was work by Kato and Tat in 2019, which handled the general case, in particular the case where it's maybe it's not a complete intersection. I will go back to this later. So this raises some questions. So can we generalize the results from Dulin and Hattori to higher rank evaluations? And if so, can we globalize? By globalize, I mean if you have a value space like your ASIC space or I mean the ASCII Riemann space, do we have such a result for rig etal covers, cache etal? Okay. But first, already the cache evaluation is already not obvious, and this is what we consider in this lecture. So, why would we be interested in such results? It will give a refinement of Scholz's perfectoid equivalence, very much like Dulin's result refines the Fontaine Wittenberge equivalence. If we had globalized and for higher rank evaluations results of this nature, we would have a refinement of the perfectoid equivalence without going all the way to perfectoid total. So let me fix some notation. I will only consider Hänselian valuation. So, yeah, we call it A for the base ring with Frasch config K. It has some value group K star mod S star. That's in the game A. There is a residue field A mod maximal ideal and a characteristic exponent of residue field P. Most of what I will discuss will be basically moot for P equal to 1. So we can safely assume P is prime in what follows. Now I will be interested in extensions, the coefficient extension and the integral closure of A in this extension. I call it B. It is also Hänselian valuation ring because A is Hänselian. And it has some residue field L, which is an extension of K. Okay, now ad hoc definition. We said that the finite extension M of K is purely fiercely ramified if it is separable, if the ramification degree is trivial, meaning that they have the same value group, and if the field extension, the residue field extension M of K is purely inseparable. So perhaps the simplest example of such extension is as follows. We take a base field of class P, and we take a Hattie-Schreier extension given by this C, T minus P. Oh, sorry. Let's say T, K is a Laurent series, and T is a uniformizer. And I take C to be in a unit which is not a P-fourer in the residue field. Okay. As it turns out, this Hattie-Schreier extension is purely fiercely ramified in this sense, and the residual extension is simply given by extracting a P-fruit of C. Okay, so this is one typical example. There is another kind of example, which is a lot more subtle, given by extensions with defects. It is quite possible to have a purely fiercely ramified extension, which is non-trivial, but for which the residue field extension is trivial. Okay. This is a very bad behavior for such an extension. Now we have the following proposition, du coup, catotat. It is a variant of Abiancar's lemma in a sense. So as you well know, if you have a valuation, extension valuation, by using a log etal extension of a base, we can kill the prime to P part of the extension of a value group. Okay. But actually, if we allow log smooth extension, we can kill the whole extension of Federoop, and you can actually get a purely serranified extension, provided we start with a finite separable extension. Okay, so it comes at a cost, but even if you start with a very simple reduced field, like a perfect field, for example, or even finite, then the new residue field, okay, prime, will be possibly very complicated, or at the very least, non-perfect. Typically, it will be a field of rational functions over the base field. There is a variant where we suppose that the extension is defectless. So, as I mentioned, defect, what does this mean? It means that the degree of extension is equal to the inertial degree, so the residual extension, times the exponent, but times the ramification degree, the cardinality of gamma B over gamma A. It's not always an equality. If you have equality, we say it is defectless or without defect. And in this particular case, you can even arrange that the new extension after base change becomes a finite, flat, complete intersection. Actually, if you're not familiar with defect, it's fine if you take this as a definition of defectless, being a finite complete intersection after Luck smooth base change. Actually, it's much more illuminating and the original definition of defect. And what happens?
A finite complete intersection means that the extension of integer ring is a finite complete intersection.
Yes, indeed. Yes, it's B is as A algebra is a finite flat complete intersection. Exactly. Yes. Mostly, we are interested in the ring of integers. The structure of the field extension itself is not that relevant to ramification theory. It's really about the integral structure. So this is what happens when we take a large log smooth extension. What happens if we go further? The answer is not much. So if we are already purely serranified, we make a further log smooth extension of the base field, then we stay purely serranified, and the new integral closure is just the most basic base change. So in terms of structure of ring of integers, it becomes very simple. Okay. Now I take a non-zero, say proper ideal I of A, or if you want, of the integral closure A bar of A in a separable closure, but I will not be interested in specifically now. And we take some log smooth extension such that the new base change extension, or composite extension, is purely fiercely ramified. Then we have the following definition, still from Kato et al. The finite extension out of K is said to have log ramification bounded by I if the base change extension has non-log ramification bounded by I. As you recall, this was non-log ramification was defined in Kato Sensei's lecture on Monday. But I will maybe give a reminder in a few minutes, just not right now. So it was basically the same idea as in the Abbe-Saito theory. It was using a variant of the Abbe-Saito varieties, and basically the same idea. What's interesting is that this definition is independent of the choice of K prime over K. Only one with this property is will do. Now let's see what we can do with this. So let's consider the log smooth extensions of A. Let's say it's a site. It's not a very interesting site, but anyway. Why do I want to consider it a site? It's so you can imagine what would happen if we wanted to globalize this result. in which case we would have an attic space, and you would, which is endowed with a natural log structure, and you consider log smooth morphism to that attic space. So on this site, we have the sheaf of things, bog A, which is simply the structure sheaf of the integral structure sheaf. And more generally, if we have a finite separable extension, we can consider bog B, which is simply given on A prime by the integral closure of A prime in this base change. So here it's possibly a finite product of the compositum extension. This L tensor K point. So I put the quasi coherence here. Why? Well, because of this theorem by Kato Tat, which I mentioned here. It becomes quasi coherent if you go away enough in this site. If M over K is defectless, then by the same results, bold B is finite locally free, as in bold A algebra. Okay, so these were our basic objects. Now they live as sheaves on this very simple site. Now let's consider again a non-zero proper ideal I of A. And there is a very simple way to construct a log ring, a logarithmic ring with this data. We take a monoid MA, or MA underline, which is the non-zero element of this variation ring A, mod 1 plus I. It's a group acting on a monoid. And we have a canonical homomorphism for monoids to A mod I. And you can verify that it is indeed the logarithmic structure, meaning that the inverse image of the invertible of A mod I is equal to invertible of A mod 1 plus I, which is exactly A mod I invertible in the morphism. It's also a very particular log structure because this homomorphism of monoids is surjective, which means that our monoid is basically as big as it gets. It's very large. Now, I will consider so-called purely fierce extension of this underlying A, which is now some kind of residue logarithmic ring. It's a non-zero morphism to some logarithmic ring B, such that in terms of a value group, in a way, in the monoid mod invertible, it is an isomorphism. If you like gamma A called gamma B, but of course B is not a relational ring here, so it makes sense to speak of gamma B. We also ask the structure homomorphism to be surjective and B to B. And you ask that the residual extension of a mod I to B is finite Korean separable. Well, the assumption here implies that B is a local ring, actually, and that a mod I to B is a local homomorphism. We say that this extension is defectless if B is furthermore finite flat MOG algebra. We could add a complete instruction in this sentence. It does not change much to what I will tell now. Okay, so this is our basic structure. And now we consider, we say that we have an etal, or rejectal if you like, defectless underlying log algebra. This is what? This is a quasi-coherent underlying log algebra B. So basically a sheaf of such things, if you replace A by A prime, which is locally on the site, a finite product of purely fierce defectless extensions. Okay. In particular, finite product of local. Example, because if we take L of K, finite separable defectless extension, and we construct a logarithmic ring as before, using this mod 1 plus I construction, we obtain such an object. So locally, it is indeed a final product of purely fierce FLSS engine, again by the result of that aforementioned. Okay. Very well. Now for such objects, for defect etal underlying log algebra, I'm going to define some kind of ramification. It's basically the same definition as in Abbe-Saito or Saito or Kato-Tax. We take a finite generating set for B of F prime. We take some F prime big enough, a log smooth extension of A. And we have a solutive morphism polynomial ring to B of A prime. And the canal is generated by I and by some finite set of polynomials. Okay. Possibly as many as the number of indeterminates. Now, if I take some elements pi, such that I is contained in the ideal generated by pi, then we can set f a pi of b evaluated at a prime to be the set of connected components of this Abbe-Saito variety or Abbe-Saito edit space. I will not recall it here. It's exactly the same as the one defined and used in Kato-Sensei's lecture. Okay, so this is the same notation, exactly the same notation. Okay. Now we have a definition. So here we still at the level of truncated evaluation, if you like. B is an amodi algebra. We said it's an affiliation bounded by pi if this FA pi is a local constant of planarity rank of B. And likewise, we say that two morphisms from B1 to B2 are equivalent or pi equivalent if they have the same morphism from FA on pi to FA by B2. Okay, so the thing is, when we work mod I with A mod I algebra, there are much more morphisms that we would like. Basically, when we are at the level of A, so not mod I, the condition of minimorphism is much more stringent, much more restrictive than mod I. So we need to do something to take care of these extra morphisms. Okay, so I mentioned before that we have a construction of from a finite ideal algebra to or extension, if you like, to this A mod I ideal algebra in a sense. And this will become an equivalence of categories if we make enough assumptions, enough restrictions. So let's assume that my ideal I is a principle. It's very convenient for construction. So it will become an equivalence of category between finite ideal defectless algebra with low ramification within my I. This is the structure at the level A. And then we have the structure at the level M mod I, which is the ethyl and the line algebra with log ramification bounded by I in the sense that I just defined here. And we identify equivalent morphisms as before, as defined before. Okay. I should have added the defect keys. Okay. The thing is, the problem is that, so this seems nice, but actually it's not quite what one would hope. Because the definition I took here of ramification and equivalent morphisms, it very much depends on the choice of A, a priori. Okay. Because the structure, the objects are considered like a ball B, A underline Lagrange algebra, it seems as it's dependent only on the structure mod I. But now we kind of broke this property because we define a new category using A and not A mod I. So we would like to show that it is independent. It's not clear enough that why it is, but basically the result of the Lingen Hattori are essentially result of this type, but in particular cases, when we start with a nice enough evaluation ring. Okay, and of course, if we want to globalize to an analytic space, it's an important step to show that this is independent of yourself or of a lift A. And of course, we would like to be able to take a base ring A with the same underlying A, but possibly of different characteristics. Like, for example, we could take a coin ring in one variable of QP and compare it to a two-fold long series of HP. This type of thing should compare. But right now, it's not clear that they do. Okay, maybe I know I give an example of where it's actually pretty easy to see that it is independent of the shocks of lift. It's the case of a WP extension. So we take a defectless purely fixed extension. So maybe I should have commented on defectless, why I have assumed this. So in the structure I will show here, it will be clear how we do this defectless. We want something which is finite flat to gain some structure. But it's not unreasonable to expect results like before in the defect case. It's just that we do not have such a nice structure a priori. So Katotat, or maybe Tat, showed that even if we are not finite flat completed session, we are still inductive limit of such things. But of course, if you want to compare to the categories, it becomes more complicated to consider inductive limit of objects rather than objects themselves. Okay, so I will not assume too much, but it should work the same for defect case. So let's see what happens in the rank P case in the purely fierce extension. So the residue field is non-trivial because of defectless assumption, and it is degree P, so it is of the form expression of P fruit for some C which is not a P fruit but in K. So let's take a lift in B on this P fruit and a lift of this C in A. And then we have the next property that S to the power P minus C is small in a sense. It's in, the maximum ideal of A times B. So in case it wasn't clear before, this MA times B is coincides with the maximum ideal of B. Okay. And furthermore, B is a free module on M mod I if base is the power of S. Okay, so it's fairly simple. And you can also do directly the evaluation in terms of expansion in these bases. Okay, so now we can expand with some SP minus C like this, with some AJ, the maximum B. This gives us a polynomial equation satisfied by S. So here it is. Okay. And basically, we have a monogenic extension. So everything works very nicely in the monogenic case. We have a Newton polygon. Newton polygons, and it's even simpler because of the coefficients we are interested in have a very simple expression for the evaluation. So we can consider this analog of Hondian polygon, so a function from interval 0 minus 1 to gamma tensor Q. It's the largest convex map. So it's convex in the sense of multiplicative evaluation. So it's reversed. it's multiplicative notation. Such that it equals to 1 and 0. So 1 is the neutral element. And such that we have this following inequality for I in between 1 and t minus 1. We can extend it to interval 0 p by linearity in the last segment. Okay, so this is because we are tensor Q. And we have the following nice characterization. The ramification is good then by pi if and the log ramification, I mean, is bounded by pi if and only if psi of p is larger than pi to the p. Yeah. Oh, I said log ramification, but of course it is the same here. Oh, if we were at the level of actual evaluation, it would be the same because we said that in the first ramification case, log equal non-log. Okay. So basically the definition. And in this example, if you think about it, what happens if you move? So actually the whole definition here of psi makes sense for the coefficient mod pi. And so we have independence in this case of a notion of being having bounded ramification. But of course, in general, even if you take a first ramified case but of rank P to the N, say, we can have a much more complex situation and even more complicated if we allow defect. Because then the structure, we still have structure theorem, but much more complicated. Okay. Very well. Well, oh, okay. I will end here. Thank you.
Okay, thank you very much.
Yeah.
Questions?
So, maybe this is not another comment than a question, but So today you explained what's going on for discrete variation, but eventually we expect it to globalize. And if it works, then maybe we can ask to put the hand on the characteristic cycle. So in characteristic P, we have a nice theory of single support and characteristic cycle, but we don't have this in mixed characterization. But if you in this bounded ramification situation, we can transport the theory in character P to mixed characters case. So so in some concrete example, we can test we can test this expectation in some concrete example. So you have some idea or some feeling on this point of view?
So actually this was one of my motivation originally. So we take a smooth variety, at least in the equal characteristic case for now. And you look at the diagonal. And so you are in a situation where you have a ring, B and sub B, and an ideal, the diagonal ideal, B and sub B. And you're interested in things which live on B and sub B mod I, which is just the original scheme. And we want to study the ramification along valuation above. And yes, so this was one of the innovations. And well, I guess in this best set of variety, well, I mean, you're much more familiar with this than me, but of course, but we can also look at the diagonal. It replaces valuation by blue. It gives basically the same thing. Yes.
Thank you.
So are there?
So Gemma has a question.
Yeah, but as great.
Yeah, he had one. Yeah. So, but.
Yeah. Ofer, you can speak. Yeah, we hear you. No.
Yeah.
Can you unmute your microphone? Ofer?
Yes. I am. Oh,
yes.
Okay,
yes.
Okay. So you refer to this paper of Delin in this book from the early 80s about this theory for perfect residue field discrete valuation. So, I think that in this independence of the truncation, he had slightly more complicated structure. As far as I remember, he had the DVR mod M to the N. He also considered the maximal ideal mod despair, which is like considering this log structure. So
exactly, it's an analog of log structure in the case of discrete valuation. It is actually the same as the log structure. It's more than the log structure because we have an additive structure also in the monomine, of course. But
what did you say again?
It's a little. It's little more than the log structure in the case of the line. So the reason that why things are a little simpler here. So basically, it's because we are in this purely fierce extension case, and we don't see the extension of valuation, the same value group, basically. And so we don't need more, actually, because everything is deduced on the base.
We obtain, this is after, this is a definition of what?
If you want the tangent space of B, so maximal ideal mod maximal to the square, it's in this particular case, it's equal to the tangent space of A, tensor B, because of this purely fierce assumption.
Yeah, but when you say that something, you said something about a category of things which are extension, a category at tau less than or equal to I, which you define, or the factless one, and you said it doesn't depend on the lift, and if you want to, doesn't depend in the strong sense, doesn't depend on some unique equivalence, then do you need to introduce this extra structure like in the Lin's paper?
So we don't need to add it, but you're right in the sense that we need to remember it for A or for A prime. Okay. If you have it for A prime, then you have it for all B, this extra structure, because of this purely fierce assumption. Okay. So we do not need it in the category, but you are right, I think, that we need to remember more about
in the Lin's theorem, when you have an isomorphism, you have to specify it on the extra structure in order to get an equivalence of categories.
Yes, exactly. So if we want to show what is dependent on the lift, we need to take into account this extra structure, like in the Lin. Indeed.
And now, can you specify why is it in the Lin's thing, is it the same as giving the log structure? You said it's not exactly the same. Can you say?
So it's a little more general. So if we take, So you look at this, MA, and No, okay, so you look at the inverse image of the generators of the maximal ideal. Okay.
Yes.
And you get some GM torsor.
Yeah.
Okay, that GM torsor is the line bundle the link considers.
So, but in the discrete valuation truncated case, the Lin thing is exactly the equivalent.
So the Lin consider a morphism from there's a truncated ring R, and a morphism from M to R, where M is not here a Mandeville, it's a free R module of rank one. So it's a line bundle, if you like. A GM torsor, and we can recover this GM torsor from the fiber of this. So maybe we actually do not need to remember it because it's already here. Yeah.
Ah, okay, this is already.
Anyway,
it seems that it is equivalent, that the structure of the Lin is equivalent to giving this log.
Yes, yes. Because we have a GM torsor by taking the inverse image of uniformizers. So,
Okay, thank you. So are there any, I don't see any other questions, but so let's thank the speaker again. Thank you very much. And those who want, they can meet at on Gazerton in something like 33 minutes. Okay, thank you very much.
Okay, so see you on Gazerton.
Bye.